So, faults are breaks in the Earth's crust. We can identify them because of the discontinuity in the structure within the Earth crust across the fault, and earthquakes occur on these faults, so very processes by which these faults move to a large extent is due to earthquakes. So, we have a fault plane and the earthquake is so focused on this fault plane and the earthquake starts at the particular point on the fault plane and we call that the focus of the earthquake. The rocks propagate out from that point on the rupture to cover the entire fault plane. The rupture is in that particular earthquake. We talked about the epicenter of the earthquake a lot. The epicenter is just the surface projection of the focus of the earthquake. So, if you wanted to look at the map view where the earthquake was located, we would be able to look that into the earth. We would see the focus down some depth in the earth or the epicenter, just a point vertically above that focus at the surface of the earth. So, this is the relationship between the faults and the earthquakes.
What exactly are the basic human rights? Who gets to pick them? Who enforces them, and how? The history behind the concept of human rights is a long one. Throughout the centuries and across societies, religions, and cultures, we have struggled with defining notions of rightfulness, justice, and rights. But one of the most modern affirmations of universal human rights emerged from the ruins of World War II with the creation of the United Nations. The treaty that established the UN gives us one of its purposes to reaffirm faith in fundamental human rights. And with the same spirit, in 1948, the UN General Assembly adopted the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. This document, written by an international committee chaired by Eleanor Roosevelt, lays the basis for modern international human rights law. The declaration is based on the principle that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. It lists 30 articles recognizing, among other things, the principle of non-discrimination and the right to life and liberty. It refers to negative freedoms, like the freedom from torture or slavery, as well as positive freedoms, such as the freedom of movement and residence. It encompasses basic civil and political rights, such as freedom of expression, religion, or peaceful assembly, as well as social, economic, and cultural rights, such as the right to education and the right to freely choose one's occupation.
With the concept of moral objectivism, what we're looking at is the idea that there can be some universal moral principles, some rules, some ideas and guidelines that are valid for all people in all social environments and all situations. The idea that we can essentially have some signposts or a roadmap to guide behavior is going to be consistent across all individuals. Now, if we take a look at this from another perspective, we can come up with a view of moral absolutism. In the area of moral absolutism, basically, what we have illustrated on the right-hand side of this slide is a very firm and unyielding boundary between what is right and what is wrong. And so, within moral absolutism, basically what you have are these non-overridable principles. They must be followed. They must never be violated, and there were no exceptions. It is always right. It is always wrong. And nothing is subject to interpretation, and nothing is dependent upon the situation.
I think there are pretty dire consequences if we don't ensure that we invest in children and families, particularly children and families in poverty. We can certainly try and pay for these things later on in life.
Right.
But that's incredibly expensive. It's incredibly draining on public resources, draining on private resources. And there are so many needs in the community. The more we can focus on children and families early in their development, the better off we'll be in terms of our own public resources, public education and public health. The other thing that I would recommend is we think about linking the two together,
right?
We have these systems of health. We have these systems of education, but rarely are the two talking to one another. So in particular, in those early years, just before a child is born and then in through those first 5 years, it's critically important that we invest early on. That way we can make sure that individual is on the right path to start school and to start helping. Economists tell us that for every dollar that we invest in a child's life before they turn 6 years old, returns over $7 of community benefits back to all of us. And so what that means for first time and for our county is that every dollar we're investing our communities can down the road as this child gets older, as they succeed through school, and as they become productive citizens.
Thank you.